heard this morning from the radio that General David, the AFP chief of staff, was quoted saying he was not, his input was not asked about the amnesty plan. Is that true?
Actually, when we asked him about that yesterday, he said, or even his spokesman would say that they were consulted through the Secretary of National Defense. Of course, it would be part of the culture of soldiers to just obey orders. So he was quoted in the papers as saying, and I heard it, I even put it in my story that appeared today, that they would have preferred to continue the court-martial for these rebel soldiers. But then, I think they are supportive of the amnesty provided that the officers who joined anti-Arroyo uprisings would not be reinstated, presumably because they still have the influence, while the enlisted personnel would be allowed to go back to military service. I think the military would support President Aquino's policy regarding amnesty, but I think they're not in favor of reinstating them. And I think they believe that it would not be a bad precedent. In fact, they believe it would discourage coups because it shows the sincerity of the administration in fostering unity and reaching out to sectors deemed critical to
but, the But in terms of a professional culture, they missed the boat on this one because the people within the establishment wanted the court-martial to just play out.
Well, that's what General David would say, but then they can't do anything. It's the commander in chief that speaks.
I just want to put the perspective that during the time of President Aquino, Corazon Aquino, the late President Corazon Aquino, during the time of her administration, there were several coups, fake coups, isn't it? But then she did not go to that extent to planting amnesty. It took President Fidel Ramos, her successor, to give amnesty to the mutineers after peace talks. It was a product of peace talks with the rebel soldiers. This time, even before they could ask for amnesty, they were given already by the palace under the present dispensation. So one of our fellow colonists, Dick Pascual, had in his conversation, he was asking, so it is a coup against Arroyo, is it okay?
Is it okay?
Yeah. That's a legitimate question.
There's an interesting thing here, which I also mentioned in my column. The first 100 days practice was actually from the time of Franklin Delano Roosevelt, where he faced a major economic crisis and he needed to pass certain laws, which the U.S. Congress needed to process. And the U.S. Congress, both lower and upper house, simply passed it, and it was a 15-week honeymoon. So there were no squabbling, they passed the law because they needed to. In the first 100 days of the Aquino administration, has there been a series of legislative agendas submitted to the Congress in the same way that there was during Roosevelt's time?
No, they haven't submitted any. In fact, that's what the opposition bloc in the chamber would badger the palace to call for a redact, which is the legislative executive government of the Council of Council. Basically, that mechanism for the executive and Congress to talk and agree on a legislative agenda. But understandably, the majority would not admit to that it was a legislative agenda. They're saying that this budget, such as the piece of legislation. It's one major piece of bill that would chart the budget for next year. And basically, that's it. The budget, maybe even this amnesty proclamation. Even the fiscal measures, it's been acknowledged by the House leadership that there'd be no new taxes. So that's out. There's nothing about new taxes.
What about the Truth Commission? Well, isn't that something that has to go through Congress or?
That's executive.
It's purely executive.
Yeah. Although some congressmen or lawmakers are grumbling that the president may have usurped the powers of Congress.
No, remember, the Truth Commission was issued during Congress while was not in session. So that's fairly legal.
Yeah.
So Congress cannot claim being usurped because they're not in the session, the 15th Congress.
Yeah.
And going back to the legislative agenda, I think Pinoy has laid it down during his first one at the State of the Nation address. And we listed at least 7 of them on his priority agenda.
Yeah.
And one of the issues regarding tax measures, but on the promise no new taxes. But in his sauna, he said fiscal responsibility. So when I asked about people about it, especially Financial Secretary Cesar Purisima, he told us that fiscal responsibility is upon Congress, it's actually a call to Congress, that they should not file bills or enact laws that do not provide funds to bankroll it. Because we have so many laws that are implemented because no funding are available. So that I think is the fiscal responsibility bill is something that Congress would not dare touch right now because they want is some popular or rounding points for them. So in fact, I think the House Committee on Ways and Means that passed the tax measures headed by Congressman from Batangas, Bandanas, even wants to reduce the VAT from 12% to 6%. And the palace is worried about that because what they want right now is more revenue, not to increase the budget deficit, which is now the major problem of this government.
We said we want to give an assessment, but on the ground. What is the real score with real people? I'll start with you, Chu. You're in the center of things. You're the news editor. You're a columnist.
Yes.
Not all columnists get as much information as you do. First 100 days, what's your assessment on Aquino?
Actually, that 100 days is some sort of a tradition, but in reality, for me, it's unrealistic to demand something out of the man, out of the presidency. It's just for me, first 100 days is just for us in media to observe some holding back, some restraint in these systems because the presidency is not a one-man job. It's a job of all of us. It's not, we just have the role model or the leader to do the things we want for our country. So I would not be too much demanding from Pinoy because I have covered his late mother, President Rosan Aquino, then Fidel Ramos, Joseph Estrada, Governor Capagal Arroyo, and only this time I was not able to cover him, which I'm now in this position. So I'm more lenient in terms of giving the presidency the first 100 days. So as far as I'm concerned, Pinoy is doing well enough, so I will not downgrade his, I will not give him any failing grade for the first 100 days. In fact, he has inherited 9 years, more than 9 years of what could have been the failures or mistakes of the previous administration, like what his mother, late mother, had experienced when the late President Rosan Aquino inherited the 20 years of the martial law regime, its failures and its accomplishments.
Okay, but would it be unfair to say, as people have observed, that Pinoy is repeating the same things that his mother did, or is doing it same all over again? His cabinet is split the same way that Cory's cabinet was split several times. Cory had Menjola, Pinoy has Quirino. And I know it's not their fault, but they seem to, people are saying deja vu.
Yeah, deja
vu. What is this? Is this correct or is this just unlucky turn of the point?
I think it's just destiny for me. It's all about destiny.
Okay. What about these people?
These people, if there's one comment that I can make, sort of a criticism of the first 100 days of administration, is the choice of people in these cabinet appointments and other presidential appointments. They were telling us they have a search committee. But it turns out the search committee is not a search committee at all. There's no such search committee because when I asked Executive Secretary Pakito Ochoa about the search committee, was telling us, or he told us, that the final choice is the president's choice. So there are many criticisms about barkadas, classmates, and unfortunately there are just criticisms about kamag-anakin. I think he's very much aware of not committing the same mistake. Well, I mean, repeating that kind of perception of kamag-anakin. But he's now under fire for appointing people who are his Ateneo-based schoolmates or classmates, his barkada. Because I think he wants to surround himself with people he has been told, I mean, associates, close associates. He wants to surround him with people that he has known for a long time, but not necessarily on competence some of them on integrity. But you know, there's no perfect people around now.
What are the people in your area saying as far as the selection of cabinet members, government officials? What's the buzz at the Congress?
Even coming from the administration Congress, they're saying that they're giving the president high marks. Mm-hmm. And this is shared by many of them, especially the fact that he enjoys so much trust from the people. However, they also agree on the perception on they're not too comfortable with the way the president chooses his cabinet officials. And in fact, one close ally of his congressman, giving high marks, all A's, practically on governance, trust, and anti-corruption, and everything. But it was obviously what he called selecting people, gave him a D. So I think that the perception should be also addressed by the president and how he chooses his efficiency.
Would it be safe to say, that's what I'm personally presuming, that after the same people go to the commission on appointments, only 30% would survive the slaughter?
Well, understandably, those making those threats are really coming from the minority bloc.
No, but I mean, this Congress, yeah. the real score. If we were now to line up all of Pinoy's choice and the search committee's recommendation, if they now go through the commission on appointments, how many percent will survive the slaughter?
I think maybe a bit higher, although there'll be some casualties, but I think they're
35?
But I think they're gonna manage it in such a way that they won't even go through the ringer, as you said, like to the CA. Mm-hmm. I think there'll be some backroom maneuvers for them to withdraw the appointment and change it, to spare the president.
Is that going on already? Because yeah, I think that some people have made calls to the president.
Yeah, and I think they're already, the fact that it's been announced with some of the cabinet officials, and they're announcing active capacity, I think that's an opening for the president, to withdraw such an appointment, or to withdraw this in a capacity.